soon, Cadence Next.
Hello and welcome to Retro Game Connect. I'm Dan Mastriani.
I'm Ian Butterfield.
And today we're playing something a little newer than I usually like to, but we promised. So today we're going to be playing Okami for PS2.
I have a shirt with him on it.
You do? You have a shirt?
And it's Pokemon, but also...
Okay. Amaterasu.
Amaterasu.
Yes. The suit is kind of under voice, so you want to... Amaterasu.
Amaterasu?
Amaterasu.
Ah. I don't know how to pronounce Japanese.
It's all right. And most people... Yeah,
Pokemon.
There you go, which is short for two English words, so... Yeah.
But Okami.
Yeah, it's kind of loosely based on Japanese mythology.
It's loaded with it.
Yeah, but, you know, like in Japanese mythology, Amaterasu is the goddess of the sun. She's basically head of the pantheon. But basically, while the characters are all named after Japanese mythology, they kind of wanted to make it clear that it's not necessarily supposed to be like the...
It's not like the mythos.
Yeah, exactly.
It's just a story involved. It's sort of like God of War, but family friendly.
Ish. Yeah. Not as many people murdered in this game.
I mean...
Not that that's hard.
I mean, you do kill a lot of things.
I suppose.
They're mostly demons, though.
Yeah, yeah. But, you know, in the original mythology, she's the sun goddess. And actually, Susanoo is her brother, which is not something that's, you know, represented in the game.
Yeah, no.
No, they're not related in the game. No. But there are a lot of things that tie into the original myth. Kind of summarize, basically, the story is, you know, her brother.
It samurai-ized them?
Yes, yes. No, that's Power Rangers, but I think. But Susanoo was basically making a mess up in heaven, and we'll say, you know, the Japanese equivalent anyway. And Amaterasu was so upset she retreated into a cave. And they lured her out with a mirror, which, you know, reflected her beauty. And then they tied a rope at the back of the cave so she can go back all the way into the cave. And that's how Japanese mythology explains the sun coming up and down.
Hence her weapon being a mirror.
Exactly, yes,
weapon.
The celestial mirror.
Yes.
Yeah, so these are all elements that are in the game, which is why I want to summarize it. But that's actually the myth that explains day and night in Japanese mythology. It's her...
See, in this,
it's
just you paint the sky.
Yeah. It's her retreating into the cave that causes the sun to go down at night. But then she can't get all the way back. She has to come back out of the cave, which is morning.
Oh.
So that's how they... Yeah. And there are lots of other things. And actually, this comes up later. Susanoo, despite being the villain of that story, he becomes the hero in a later story where he takes on the Yamato no Orochi, which is... This is a spoiler? I think he... No, he's involved early on in the story.
Susanoo, yeah.
Yeah, but the Orochi.
Orochi,
yes.
Yeah, the Japanese Hydra.
Yeah. So he's the one that defeated in Japanese mythology, so that's another thing they draw.
And you kind of defeat him, but Susanoo looks like he does.
Yeah, but he... It's in the original mythology, I'm not sure how much of this, at least off the top of my head, that... Okami draws on, but in the original mythology, basically what he does, you know, the Orochi has been devouring maidens, and Princess Kushinada is the latest sacrifice. So he says, "I'm going to save her," and what he has her parents to do is brew him up, you know, 8 barrels of wine, and he gets it drunk. And then while it's passed out drunk, he cuts off his head.
That's pretty much what you do in this.
Yeah.
You bring the sacrificial wine. Might be sake in this. I don't remember.
Well, that is a type of wine. So
yeah.
Same difference.
And you fill the pool with it. And then as you fight him, you have to use your water brush ability to get the head drunk, and then you can attack it.
Yeah.
But it also kind of has... similar celestial powers to Okami, so you have to actually combat it because it'll start blowing wind, and so you have to, like, blow the wind the other way. And, oh, it's blowing fire. Well, you can use wind to deflect the fire.
Well, isn't that kind of like a close to the end of the game? So maybe we're...
Oh, God, no. That's like the first quarter of the game.
Oh, is it? Oh,
the
fight
with Orochi is, like, really early.
Okay.
Because you kill Orochi. I remember doing it. You beat Orochi, and then it's like, ah, and now there's more adventure. Because that was like, well, that seemed kind of short. And it was like, oh, well, now there's 2/3 more of the map to go, well, even more, 3/4 of the map to explore. And I was like, oh, okay.
Yeah, I don't know if the Murakumo no Tsurugi figures into the game at all, but that is a legendary Japanese weapon, which actually came from the body of Orochi.
The Moonblade.
It could be.
You do get a sword at the end of the battle with Orochi.
Yeah, so that's drawing on, again, that's drawing on the original legend. And I believe...
if you haven't figured out, this might get a little spoilery.
Yeah.
Just because we kind of want to explore the myth behind this.
And also, I'm not really clear on the mythology behind it, but...
To be fair, there aren't too many plot twists. Like, no, there are only a couple major, like, moments.
Yeah, I don't think we're gonna get into that, but... Yeah. I believe also she uses beads, and that oddly shaped bead is another, you know,
it's called a rosary bead in this.
Yeah, but Japanese would be a magatama, and I'm not really super clear on the mythology of that.
I played this game a lot
when
I was younger, so I kind of remember, and I even picked up the HD edition. While I haven't finished it, I have played into it some.
Yeah, so those are like the three great treasures of Japan is. Of course, you know, the whole, imperial sword,
the sword,
the Murakumo no Tsurugi, which is also known as the Kusanagi.
Kusanagi, I think that's what it's called, just Kusanagi.
Yeah.
In the game, at least.
Yeah, it depends
on... It's like the first sword you get.
I think, you know, in the Orochi myth, it's Murakumo no Tsurugi. Originally, it's, and later on, it's renamed to the Kusanagi because imperial... one of the, I don't think he was emperor at the time, but someone in the imperial line used it to fight off, I don't remember exactly how it goes, but basically he did a big slash and he cut a lot of grass, so they renamed it Kusanagi, which is grass cutter.
You might do something like that in the game. There are a lot of moments where, like, other people are supposed to have the limelight, but you use your celestial brush to help them. Like, in the battle with Orochi, Susanoo does show up after you've been fighting it this whole time. And he delivers the final blows to all of the heads. But what happens is he does a slash, and then you do the celestial brush slash, and it actually does the damage.
Yeah.
So he's using, like, a wooden sword.
Yeah.
Because logic. Yeah. Like, there's a twig growing off of it with a leaf.
Yeah, so, you know, again, it doesn't directly, but those are all the three treasures. You know, there's the celestial mirror, which is, you know, part of the sun goddess legend, and the Magatama bead.
And
which,
those are
again,
all,
I don't remember it
all.
Those off
the top
are all
the weapon types in the game.
Yeah.
Bead, sword, mirror, which all get used different ways depending on if you assign them to your primary or your secondary. Because in your primary, the mirror just, like, you know, comes off of your back and attacks things as you slash at them with it. But if you set it to your secondary, it acts as a shield.
Yeah.
But if you catch them perfectly with it, you can do, like, a grapple move when they attack you with a melee one. The rosary beads, if you use them as your primary, my chair is sinking. if you use them as a primary... Yes, I have a sinking feeling about this. If you use them as your primary, you use them like a whip, and you can actually see her kind of holding on to the end of it with her mouth. But if you use them as a secondary, you magically shoot them out of your mouth as like a bullet. And then the sword, if you use as a primary, you kind of slash around with it, and you can charge the slash. And if you use it as your secondary... you have, like, one really powerful, just one slash. I always like to do a sword as my primary and a shield, a mirror as my secondary, have that defense mode.
Yeah, that makes sense. So we should probably, of course, the game was created by Clover Studio, which was basically a subsidiary of Capcom. They were kind of independent, but Capcom owned them, but they got to do their own thing. Clover was actually built out of Production Studio 4, which was run by Shinji Mikami, of course, the creator of Resident Evil.
Oh. This is a lot different than that.
Yes, yes.
Although it does get pretty gosh darn spooky.
Well, Mikami didn't direct this game. He was the head of Production Studio 4. And basically, I'd say Hideki Kamiya was basically something of his protege. He'd gotten to start working on the Resident Evil team. And when Resident Evil 2 came around, Mikami actually said, "Kamiya, I want you to direct the game."
Hmm.
And so that was, you know, Hideki Kamiya is how he came to be a director for the first time. And he messed up. I don't know if you've heard the story of Resident Evil 1.5, which is like the scrap version of Resident Evil 2.
No.
But basically what Kamiya said about it was that at the time, you know, he'd never directed anything before. He was a bit too easygoing, I guess is a way to put it. It's like, you know, people would come up to him with ideas and he would say yes. And he said yes to too many things, and the game was just not coming together.
And suddenly the zombies were flowers.
Yeah, I know. But they had to scrap it all. And a lot of people would be like, "Well, you're never going to be in charge of anything again." But Mikami was like, "Well, I know you're going to learn from this. I want you to keep going."
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, so
it's nice to have a second chance.
Yeah, it's because Mikami believed in him that, you know, he kept going and he started over, and we had Resident Evil 2, which was a huge hit. And, you know, after that, they'd started working on, you know, plans for the next Resident Evil, and they were taking it in a more action-oriented direction, and they felt like, well, this isn't really Resident Evil. And what they did is they rebranded it as Devil May Cry.
Oh, nifty.
So Kamiya created Devil May Cry as well. And afterwards, they had someone else do Devil May Cry 2, which did not turn out well. But Kamiya's next big game was Beautiful Joe.
I've heard of it.
Yeah, Beautiful Joe's a lot of fun. It was originally going to be a GameCube exclusive. But that was his next big project. And I guess it must have been pretty successful because a lot of the people from Production Studio 4 got spun off into Clover. Clover's first game was Beautiful Joe 2, but this is their first original game.
And they kind of make references to themselves within the game because you can find dead clovers, and if you draw a little circle around them, it brings them to life and you get orbs.
Yeah. So
I thought that was clever.
Yeah, basically one of his inspirations was, you know, they had ported the original Resident Evil to GameCube. It was basically like a remake of the game. They went in and did all new graphics and made lots of changes and things like that. So he's looking at what they could do with the graphics. And he's like, you know, amazing realistic graphics. And he's like, we can do something with the graphic quality that we've got nowadays. We can do something pretty impressive. So, you know, at the time, you know, he'd moved away from home to work for Capcom. And he started feeling a little nostalgic for his more, I don't know if he lived in the suburbs or, you know, or more rural area, but he kind of felt more nostalgic for nature. Because, you know, obviously he's working in the city to work for Capcom.
Which is a huge theme to this.
Yeah. So that was the idea that came. You know, he wanted something that kind of incorporated nature. So basically that's all they started with to begin with, is like
nature.
The nature theme, yeah. I don't know if you've ever seen the video, the very original pitch video. They had like a very realistic looking wolf just running through the field and having flowers sprout up behind it.
No.
Yeah, so at one point it was going to be like really realistic looking game.
I think they made the right decision.
They did.
The art style they did.
But the crazy thing about it is the way they came about is just somebody on the team just decided to kind of draw an ink painting style looking version of the character, like, you know, the traditional Japanese sumi-e.
So they kind of did fan art of it.
Yeah, you know, somebody was, they were one of the designers was playing around and they saw that and they're like,
yes.
This is great. And then from there, they just kind of just decided to change the entire art style.
I mean, I know Borderlands did that. They were doing that hyper-realistic style, and then instead they decided to go with a more comic book style.
Yeah, so
which worked out great for it.
it's interesting, a lot of these ideas were just kind of the strokes of inspiration.
Yeah.
You know, they weren't planning on it originally, and they just, they're like, you know what, that's a lot better than what we were doing.
And let me tell you, this game did not see the commercial success it should have.
It did not.
And that's everybody else's fault, because I bought the game.
I did too.
I bought it twice.
I only bought it once.
HD edition on PS3. Yeah. Because it is phenomenal.
I was working at a video game store at the time, and I was like, you people should buy Okami, it's really good. And people would come in, you know, like, you know, I'm looking for a good game. It was like, you know, people would be like, hey, you have something Zelda style on PS2? Like, do I? And they never bought it.
Nobody listened
to me.
It really is that sort of Legend of Zelda style gameplay, but not feeling like a clone of it, not feeling like that. It has, you know, a very mythic surrounding. It's a very unique art style to a video game. It almost, nowadays, you would see something like this on, like, the Xbox Live Marketplace in the indie section. Mm. Just because of...
But it probably wouldn't look as good.
No, but just that art style.
Yeah.
But when you look at it, when you play it, it feels unique. Even though you can say, yes, this definitely falls in the same genre as The Legend of Zelda... It doesn't feel like you're playing the PS2 version of it.
Right. Though Kamiya has said he was inspired in part by Zelda, the whole structure of the game.
Yeah.
With the overworld and the dungeons.
Oh, yeah. And so that was
a conscious influence. But when they started, he didn't really have like a concept for a game. He just, it was just nature.
Yeah.
So he's like, he didn't actually have a game, but he couldn't tell people, like, well, I have no idea what it's going to be. So he was basically like, cheerleading the team, you're like, no, this is going to be awesome. This is going to be great. Even though he didn't really have an idea for what the game was going to be. And then they were getting to a part where they were all trying to figure out at one point it was actually going to be like a simulation game where it was all hex-based and you were growing flowers and it got like really complicated.
See, here's the thing. I don't even know how they could make a sequel to this if it did meet commercial success. I know they made a game for the Nintendo DS.
Yeah, Okami then.
Yeah. I think... if this game were to have some sort of surge in popularity, you might see more of a spiritual successor. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't think you would necessarily see Amaterasu come back or anything like that. But that gameplay style is just so fantastic. The celestial brush mechanic, yeah. All of that. I'd love to see that come back.
Well, a trademark of Kamiya's games is they're all... like input-based rather than animation-based, in that, you know, a lot of games you have an animation that has to play out, and not until the animation is done can you do something else. Kamiya's games are a common aspect of them, is that usually there's some way to cancel what you're doing into something else. So you don't have to sit there and wait for the animation to finish off. You can jump out of what you're doing and, you know, create combos and, like, you know, dodge at the last minute and things like that.
Oh, yeah, I remember plenty of times in this doing a battle and I'm fighting something else and then I'll throw the celestial brush on and slash something over there as I'm still attacking something over here. Or I'll, you know, see something about to attack me and I'll cause a windstorm to distract it.
But also, I think you can just, like, cancel your attacks with a dodge or something if you're...
You can.
Yeah, so...
I think a circle is dodge.
Yeah,
and so, you can just kind of scoot out of the way.
Yeah, that's one of the other things I like about Kamiya's games, is they're all very responsive. You never feel like you're locked in and stuck doing this or that. And you can get out of there when you have to. But actually, before I forget, I wanted to mention this at the beginning, but Okami, huge pun.
Really?
Yes. The way it's written in Japanese, it means great God. But written differently, Okami can be wolf.
Oh my God, that makes this game even better.
Yeah. But back to the point I was making earlier, they didn't know what the game was going to be. They come up with this really complex idea that was just not fun. And basically, the producer on the game, Tsuchi Inaba, was like, okay, you know, you have to figure out what this game is going to be. Like, we have to make a good game, and this is not going to be it. So you guys have to sit down and figure out what we're actually doing. And they actually convened this weekend meeting. They had, like, a three-day weekend, so, like, the senior staff members had this meeting. And they're all sitting there thinking, like, well, what? what can a goddess do? What can a goddess do? And they're trying to come up with this. And then someone on the team was like, well, a goddess can do anything.
And you can really do so much in this game.
Yeah, and that was just like, was this complete shift in their thinking. And from there, they're like, a goddess can do anything.
I mean, really.
So that kind of broke the logjam and allowed them to kind of create the simple like action gameplay that they came up with. That's very cool.
But I mean, you can even pee on the bad guys. I kid you not, you can unlock an attack that stuns them by peeing on them. Not kidding. It's hilarious.
Yeah, so it was just kind of, you know, random inspiration and stuff like that. The Celestial Brush wasn't going to be in the game from the start. It's just something they came up with during development.
And it's a great mechanic because it plays into the game so much. It plays in combat, puzzle solving, in video, in anything.
Yeah.
And it becomes just such a huge part of the game.
You know, a lot of people were always asking, like, oh, you know, wouldn't this have made a great Wii game? And they're like, well, that wasn't even out when we started, for one.
Yeah. And for two, they ported it to it.
Yeah, and for two, the second thing is, you know, the Celestial Brush wasn't like the genesis of the game. It's something we added in later.
Ah.
And this game was designed for what was the most popular system at the time, the PlayStation 2. And it's designed as like an action game to start with, so we felt like buttons were kind of important.
Yeah.
So it was, you know, it was designed for that. You know, they weren't really thinking of that. They weren't thinking of the DS. They were just, see if I can find a...
I mean, now it would make a great Wii U game.
Hmm.
With that big touchpad.
Oh, yeah. That would be really good for it. Too bad to... Well, I don't know who would work on it now since all the members of Clover are at Platinum now. But we'll actually mention that.
What I'm saying is someone should make a new Okami game. Whether it's like that game that's being kickstarted that's a spiritual successor to Banjo and Kazooie, or they actually make Okami 2, I don't know, Attack of the Trees.
Yeah. Just
do it.
Here we go. Here's his quote from Atsushi Inaba. He's talking, basically the Celestial Brush came about when they changed the art style. You know, they were thinking like, well, wouldn't it be great if we could get people like involved in this nice brush art, and that's kind of the genesis of the Celestial Brush.
And the music switch in it is very cool too.
Okay.
Which you'll hear when we play it.
That. Yeah, talking about the simulation. I got that. Guys can do anything. I'm sorry that I have a bunch of like pull quotes here, so it's.
And fun fact.
I should take better notes.
As many Japanese RPGs have, there is a boss rush at the end.
Hmm. Yeah, that's a pretty standard feature.
And it's literally every single boss you fought throughout the entire game. Which again, you fight Orochi. It seems like the game's over, but. Then you're kind of like...
No, spoilers. Well, we shouldn't tell people that.
Well, but,
because so many people didn't play the game, and we don't want to ruin the end of the game for them.
Well, no, I'm not... I'm just saying, you know, you fight Orochi, and then you're like, wow, there seems like there should be more, because that seemed really short. And then, literally, the little bouncy guy, I can't remember his name for the life of me.
Isin. Yes, Isin.
Is just like, and this is only the beginning of our adventure. And you're like... Is it?
Yeah, he also wasn't originally, actually, let me see if I can find the...
He's hilarious.
Yeah, so he wasn't part of the original plan. They were thinking of a character that'd be good for navigation and guide. So they're like, well, they wanted somebody tiny, you know, no bigger than a flea, and they're like, a flea!
Yeah. And what's actually kind of nice is you can almost see a parallel to Navi, but it... Isn't as annoying as Navi?
Hey,
he's
listen.
Not like, hey, listen, hey, listen, hey, listen. He just kind of jumps off of you and bounces on stuff and then jumps back on.
Yeah.
And everybody speaks really weird in this game.
Oh, yes, that is real speech. They came up with a couple like samples and kind of mixed them around. They didn't actually call it full lines because there's so much dialogue.
Yeah,
because
it's just like, hey, 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 hey.
Yeah, but they had real people say something, and they said if they needed someone angry, they'd have them say something in an angry tone, and thing, and just kind of like, they mixed it up with like, keyboard stuff.
Wah, wah, wah,
yeah, that kind of thing.
Wah, 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 wah. I mean, there is a lot of dialogue in this game, which, unless you're Bethesda and are finally giving voice to your character, that, you know, you might want to skimp out on voice acting.
You wanted to add another NPC, but then he took an arrow to the knee.
Ah.
Oh, that's not played out at all.
Not at all.
I
always loved the cherry bomb ability in this one, though. That you could just circle in a line, and a giant bomb appears.
There you go. Yeah, so they also had a lot of work for localization because of all the Japanese references.
Yeah.
A lot of what they decided to do was just shorten names.
Ah, that makes
sense. So, like, I think one of the characters is in the English version is Kushi, and she's Kushinada in the Japanese.
Yeah, it's Kushi. Kushi is in the game, though, and you had talked about how she was the most recent sacrifice that was going to go to Orochi, and that all plays out in the game.
Yep.
It very much takes all of these Japanese myths and you play through them. Being the divine influence.
Yeah, one of the things actually they had a lot of problems with is since characters, like, you know, divine, they never actually said a gender. Which is a lot easier to do in Japanese than it is in English.
Yeah.
Because we've got all these gendered pronouns that Japanese kind of doesn't.
I think they just kind of went with she in the American one.
I found an interview with let me get this guy's name, David Krizlip, who worked on the localization, and they were saying like it was one of the things that they had a lot of problems with. So they did a lot of like the wolf or the god, so they wouldn't have so they wouldn't have to use the gendered pronoun, and because it's just a lot more difficult to do that because they didn't want to say it, but you know, generally when you're talking about a person, you say he or she.
Yeah, he, she, and they.
Yeah,
but you are doing that much dialogue on a character that can, who knows how many people are writing it? Continuity.
Yeah.
But just from my vague memory of some of it, I do want to say they call her she.
You feel like it slipped in somewhere?
I feel like it is, but also that they mentioned that it's Amaterasu, the sun goddess.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
You know, but, you immediately just go, oh, well, it's probably a female wolf.
Yeah, Japan lacks, or rather Japanese doesn't really have gendered pronouns as such, so it's a lot easier to... There's a lot of, like, implication in Japanese. Like, you can just leave a lot of words out, and they're just implied. So a lot of times...
Sort of like when I look at someone angrily.
Yeah, but, you know, you basically may there be... You won't even, like, mention the subject of the sentence, because it'll just be implied that that's who you're talking about.
Yeah.
So it's a lot easier to write something and be unclear about the gender of a character.
I do want to... From my memory of it, they do avoid using pronouns quite a bit because they'll speak about Amaterasu in the third person as Ami. Because it's not like Amaterasu actually really says anything.
No.
Amaterasu just kind of, oh!
Yeah, I like that there is actually a bark button.
Yeah, there is. When you're not in battle, you can just, I think it's like triangle, you just bark, bark.
Yeah, well, I've got the manual. We can check. But speaking of Ami, you know, in the Japanese version, what they did is they called her. Isin called her Amako, which is in, like, ko is kind of like feminine ending. You can think so. That wouldn't really make sense in English, and they were trying to come up with something. And it's actually Kami himself suggested Ami. That's actually my next point is that he was very hands-on. That's one of the things people say about him as a director is he likes to get into everything.
Just sticks his hand right in the computer.
Yeah. So he just likes to be involved in all the details instead of, you know, just going to composers like, hey, make me some music. He'd actually, like, you know, give them CDs and things like that. It's like, this is what I want this to sound like.
And the music in this game is phenomenal.
Yeah, the localizer is talking about how he was involved with all the localization decisions, came up with a lot of things, came up with, you know, the American Ami. He's the fact that the country is called Nippon in the English version of the game was another thing that was his idea. You know, in Japanese, it's called Nakatsukuni, and they thought that was too long and hard to pronounce. They had wanted to call it Yamato, which is an ancient name for Japan, but that's actually used in another part of the game, so they couldn't do that.
I'm trying to remember where, but I do remember, like, reading it.
Yeah, so they weren't able to use that.
And, maybe that was the capital city?
Could be. That's actually also in Japan. There was, like, you know, Yamato was the country, but there's also, I think, like, the capital of Yamato was Yamato.
Yeah.
So, yeah, they were talking about he was at the office all the time. He actually got married during development and didn't leave on his honeymoon until after they finished the game.
He was quickly divorced.
But yeah, he's I like this quote actually from David Grislip is he tried to make the best game he could. It's like he doesn't feel as if he owes an apology for making a really good game. So that's something that
it is a really good game.
Yeah, I'd like
and
to say
it didn't meet commercial success and that's all
no.
your fault.
Clover was too beautiful for this world.
Yes.
Yeah, after the release of God Hand, which was their last game, Clover was shut down by Capcom. And Capcom reabsorbed the division, but most of the movers and shakers decided to leave, and they formed their own company, which eventually became Platinum Games, which makes the most awesome games that nobody buys.
Honestly, I don't know what games they put out.
Bayonetta.
Oh, I know of Bayonetta.
Yes.
Sort of been meaning to buy it, but kind of never did.
I will say Bayonetta is, in my opinion, the ultimate evolution of Devil May Cry.
Yeah, I know it has a very Devil May Cry style.
But it's also from Kamiya.
Gameplay.
So Kamiya took what he did in Devil May Cry and turned it up to 11. It is the ultimate evolution of that idea, in my opinion.
Sort of personally disappointed that the sequel is a Wii U exclusive because I probably will never own a Wii U.
Hmm.
But, yeah.
Well, it was either that or no Bayonetta 2.
Oh, yeah. No. If that's what they had to do.
Bayonetta 1 unfortunately did not sell. I bought it. I tried to convince other people to buy it, but once again, nobody listens to me. Yeah, so, you know, they shut them down. Platinum, though, I think they're one of the best developers around. They did that. They've been doing several, they did several Wii U games, not just Bayonetta 2. They also did Wonderful 101, which I think looks really great. I wish I had a Wii U so I could play it. They've done that. Then this is actually probably more sum up stuff, but I'm trying to think. On DS, they actually released. Named Infinite Space in cooperation with a company with an interesting name. The company that they work with is called Nude Maker. Yeah. Alex is giving that a thumbs up. Yeah, it's an interesting name.
It's what they call me on college campuses.
Yeah, though they actually, Nude Maker actually worked on Steel Battalion, which was Capcom's crazy game where you had a $200 controller that simulated the cockpit of a giant robot, and where you had an actual eject button that you had to press when you were shot down, or else your pilot would die. And to simulate that, they would delete your save.
Oh my god, that's intense.
Yeah, so you better remember to eject if you get shot down in Steel
Battalion.
Yeah. They did that. They did Vanquish, which was Mikami's game for the company before he left, and he's now at a completely different developer. They've made a lot of like really great action games. Most recently, they actually did a Transformers game. Transformers Devastation is from Platinum. These games may be out by the time you're watching this, but
last Transformers they're working game I
on
played was
they're working on the new Star Fox.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, they've lately they've been doing a lot more contract stuff because I guess they need to make money.
Got to make the money so they can make Okami too.
Yeah, maybe Capcom will let them make Okami too, but probably not. it's really frustrating because they make the smoothest.
They'll make a spiritual successor called I Mako.
Yeah, right.
And you play as a god shark. We should probably play the game.
Yeah, let's play the game. I didn't get much sleep last night. I'm a little punchy. You have to excuse me.
Now loading.
Yeah, I like that little stamp. The stamp is probably, of course, was probably something in Japanese, but you would see the sumi art would have. People would have the artist would have a name stamp. It would stamp with like the kanji for his name, like the you know the Chinese characters, and they'd stamp it on their art.
Clover.
Oh, Clover. I miss you. But it's okay because we have Platinum now. So again, this is you know they actually got somebody to act out this, and they scrambled it. Yes, they got the cherry blossom, you know, which is another very Japanese thing, and you know a lot of cherry trees in Japan.
And you see it all over in this game.
Yes. Actually, flower viewing is a major something of a Japanese holiday. People will during the spring, where you know all the cherry blossoms fall from the tree, people will actually go out and picnic and sit under the trees as the cherry blossoms fall. Mm.
What's actually kind of fun is that little bit there where you see Orochi kind of gives you hints on to how to handle the battle with it.
Yeah. Well, that's something that would probably be very obvious to a Japanese player.
Oh, yeah, someone who
because
knows
it's a really well-known myth.
Here's that wolf running with some flowers.
As one of the interviews I was looking at while doing research, people said, hey, did you get any performance gains by switching to the cel-shaded art, and they were like, actually, this is very complicated. You know, these are high polygon models. We have a lot of shaders running. So they're actually pushing the PS2 pretty hard to get this art style.
And it looks gorgeous.
It is. That's probably one of the things I think that convinced me to buy the game was just how beautiful it looked.
Honestly, it was a lot that celestial brush.
Yeah, so we don't want to go to the tutorial, do we?
Yeah, no.
Yeah, we'll continue my game.
Wherever you happen to be.
Yes.
Kamikiville.
Apparently I'm only 5 hours in. Oh, jeez.
You are not terribly far in.
I know, I got distracted. I'm
going to have to go through.
I'm embarrassed to admit.
If you button smash, the paw prints get bigger.
Nice. I'm embarrassed to admit that I got distracted and never finished the game. Not because I didn't like it, just because I have ADD.
I finished this game at least 3 times.
I know. I've got so many great games that I would love to play, and it's hard to stick with something and then be like,
okay, let's see.
So where am I?
I've
got some stuff. I know I have the bombs.
Just divine retribution.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I do have the bombs though.
Water lily bloom, cherry bomb, power slash, rejuvenation, sunrise.
Sunrise, of course, is the very first power you get, which is appropriate because you are the sun goddess.
Yeah, and then you get rejuvenation like right after. Yeah. See what we happen to
all
be.
Right. Yeah. Okay. So I can. Yeah, I think I just got the water lily thing, so you can go further afield. I know I did the dungeon where you use the vine whip.
Oh, yes.
So I know I've done that. So I guess we're going out across the water. I love when, you know, it's like, it's one of the shaders is they used to give it like a paper look. Oh yeah, there are something you can cut lots of things in the game.
Oh, I need to fix that.
What's up?
Your controls.
My controls. It should be standard. Oh, ooh, you do inverted?
It's inverted to begin with.
Let's video output. Go up to video output. Aha!
Are we on an LCD?
We are.
Oh. You can slash everything!
You can. It doesn't.
Alright, so let's head out into the village. See, you can do.
Yep,
water lily power.
Yes.
And see, so she's just, you know.
Yep. Just going.
And we don't have the water power or the wind power yet.
I guess not. I thought I did. I remembered using it. That's odd.
Oh wait. That's dig.
Yep.
Circles bark.
Yep. I think your dodge is on R2.
Yes.
Yep. And you can dash.
Map overview.
I do have the manual.
You can buy some
recovery items. I don't think you probably need most of this stuff, but.
You usually keep a couple of those around because you can feed animals.
Yeah. I know. I'm probably just Myers away with my money.
Oh, you feed the animals and then you get orbs.
Yeah.
Little loading screen.
Yeah. Make those paw prints bigger. I don't know how far we are from a dungeon. Yeah, so do you know where we're going right now?
Yes.
Okay, good. It's been a while.
We can show off the battle mechanic real quick.
We should. Yes, fight something. Take it out. Yeah, you go into this little separate battle area. I believe you can get a bonus for slashing them like this while they're dying.
Demon tool.
Yeah, and you can use that for crafting or...
So you can rotate the camera.
Yeah, behind him. Nice. I don't know if the graphics look any different since we switched on LCD. Grew a tree under him?
Yep. Watch this. He'll come and attack me.
Are you going to try to do the...
I'm gonna do a tree block.
Okay. Nice. And finish him off. Cut him in half.
I think you get special items with the demon tooths.
Right.
And then you get a little results page, and then it disappears.
Yeah, made some money.
Ooh, feedback.
Nice. That may also be why I didn't buy stuff, because I could just get it out in the environment.
Plenty of stuff you can just find, yeah.
Yeah, I hate buying stuff that I can even just collect. I'm terrible at that when I play RPGs. I always just like collect as much stuff as I can, and I rarely buy things. I also, though, have a bad habit of just stockpiling items and never using them.
Yeah, I do that too. See, this is one of those puzzle things right here.
Right.
If I had the wind power, use the wind.
I sworn I did. You sure I don't? I remember it being kind of hard to get to work.
Yeah, no, you don't. I still remember all of the different ways you draw stuff in this. When you get the fire power, you can get a special power up if you do a little side quest that, like, isn't marked on the map. It's in the Imperial City, where you get this wicked powerful fire move that just spawns a fireball. Ooh, see? Of course.
Yay.
He needs herbs. This is one of those little scenes that actually really shows off the art style really well.
Oh, yeah.
You just kind of sit there and you feed it. And you can hit skip because, you know, you don't really have to watch the whole thing.
Well, we should have watched it at least once.
It takes a while. But you get these orbs when you do feed it.
I do. I just love how colorful the game is.
Oh, my gosh. If you get the PS3 edition, it's even better.
I hear the PS3 is a good port. Actually, I believe Hexadrive worked on that. They're pretty good as far as...
See, as you notice, you can't last in the water very long, which is why...
Gotta make yourself some...
Water lily is power. See, we're almost at the thing. Now, if I had the wind power, I would be able to just... use the wind to move my single lily pad.
Right. Perhaps you get it after this.
I don't remember when I get it.
I don't know.
You definitely get it before the battle with Orochi.
Right.
Which you are nowhere near.
All right.
Ribbit.
Yeah, well...
And if you run out of ink jars, you turn into a regular wolf.
Neat.
And then wait for it.
Whoosh. There you go. I'm trying to think if I've been in this area before, but... Yeah, so we don't have a double jump or anything at this point, right?
No. Mm-hmm. However, here's another one of those puzzle things. Need to remember what power to use.
I'm thinking a bomb.
Bomb!
Yes, I know I have that one. I guess I haven't been in here because that hasn't been blown open yet.
Yeah, no. Usually when you blow open those things, they stay open. Agataphorus. I don't know.
Japanese is very regular, so they don't really stress syllables.
So it's probably Agata?
It'd probably be Agata, yeah. Yeah, I'm not super great, but I know some basics. I took elementary Japanese back in college, so.
See, eating the food fills a special feed bag that... If you die, rejuvenates you.
Yeah, I think you actually missed it here.
Yeah, I did, but it was already full.
No, fair enough. I probably, I'm not surprised. I probably farmed them. It was probably part of why I'm not that far, because I would probably sit and farm, like, items and stuff, you know? I'm trying to remember if I knew that you could rotate the camera like that. That was a fun trick. I definitely did know you could slash guys on their way out.
I always hate battling these guys.
Yeah, so I think... Is there a last-minute dodge mechanic in this one?
Wait for it.
I know that's something that's...
Yeah, you can hit dodge while you're striking.
No, but I mean, if like you get something if you dodge like right before the attack hits you.
I don't know. See, a lot of times you can only really hurt them once they lose their color.
Yeah.
You can hurt them with the Celestial Brush.
Right. Bark at them too. Yep. Like that.
And when you bark, it shows all of your stuff.
So I like these guys are drummers. It certainly looks like playing traditional taiko drumming.
See, he lost track of where I am. He lost his color. Now he loses his mind.
There you go.
Sliced him.
Shut him in half. That's interesting. So the Japanese god of thunder is Raiden.
Oh.
And he...
Oh, it's nighttime.
Plays a drum.
Oh.
So that's the Japanese concept of, you know, where thunder comes from, is a god playing his drum.
Oh. Fun fact about these, you can do that. Nice. And they go away for a while. And when it is nighttime, there are more of them.
Mm. That makes sense. But you could, couldn't you just look at the sky and paint the sun?
Yes.
Well, why didn't you do that now?
Because I want to see what's going on here.
Well, I just thought that'd be something we want to show off.
Mm.
Good question.
And again, these
yep.
are just infinitely on fire.
Until you get the wind power up,
until
which
you
I'm
get the wind power up.
Guessing you're about to.
I don't remember.
It looks like this looks like a place where
there
you
are
would be.
Plenty of things you have to come back and get.
Yeah. Maybe.
Stray beads.
Ooh.
When you collect all of the beads, I forget exactly what happens.
I'm sure it's something good.
I forget what that does, too.
I don't know. Maybe it refills your health.
Ah, those creepy dolls.
Yeah, well, in my opinion, that's pretty much any doll. Dolls creep me out. I don't like
them. Wait for it.
Dong.
Dong. Madam Fong.
Why, it seems she was expecting you. Yeah, I'm trying to remember. I think historically in Japanese Japanese history, there were fortune tellers who would put bones in the fire and read the pattern of cracks. Like a shoulder bone of a deer, and that's how they would foretell the future.
Oh, let's see what the fortune telling is.
Yeah, fortune telling is really big in Japan, actually, even today. Obviously, they don't do it this way anymore, but. It is. Interesting.
Holy bomb. Ooh, I wonder what that can be.
Mm.
Holy bomb. Holy diva.
Down too long.
In the midnight sea. Whoop, whoop. Doesn't
yeah,
care.
I guess, you know, I guess you don't get the wind yet. I don't know.
I think the wood sprite gives you the wind.
Oh, so we are close to it. But yeah, see if you can...
Oh, my.
Ooh, yeah, that's probably
right,
bad.
Cursed zone.
Yeah, gotta be careful about that.
Feedback!
Yay. But see if you can get the sun to come out.
I think I can accomplish that.
Tomorrow. No, wait, today. Boom. Here comes the sun.
Yeah, we
gotta be that, careful about that. This Beatles song.
Notice the one of the scrolls went away.
Yes, because it can't stand the light of the sun. Oh, somebody's unhappy.
Well, somebody's in the cursed zone.
Yeah.
Oh my! What do I do? What do I do? What do I do? Highway to the danger zone.
All right, well, there's got to be something else we can do here, right?
The yeah, no, I'm
not
trying
just
to...
just visit her.
Trying to remember the next...
Have you been up that way? Is that where you came
where
from?
That's where we came from.
Okay. Oh, there's a waterfall
there. It
there
it is.
Yeah.
All along the edge of the cursed zone.
I'm always a big fan of...
checking behind waterfalls.
Running behind waterfalls, yeah. Is this where... Madame Fawn told you to go?
Yes.
Oh, there you go. So there we got a holy tree with that...
And it needs...
needs to grow.
A little help from its friends.
Exactly. You gotta be careful that their lawyers are vicious.
This is one of the great sequences that shows off again the art style.
I love how it all fills with nature.
Yes. Geez, I wonder if that's a theme.
Almost is. If it is. You know, as that person is not going to be unhappy anymore, right? Because you.
I think they're like turned to stone in the cursed zone. I forget.
Ooh, that seems unpleasant. I actually wanted to take a closer look at the face because I think it might have been a classic Japanese thing. There's these little faces they make with basic Japanese characters. So that would have been good to take a look at. Anyway, it looks like you have enough for a power-up, I think.
Ah, yes, the first set of beads.
I don't remember what Sakuya is. I'm pretty sure that's also a reference, though. So you know you're probably gonna make that. Are you gonna make it your main weapon so you can attack with that and have the mirrors to block?
I actually, oddly enough, as an aesthetic choice, I don't like having the rosary beads as a primary weapon.
I gotcha.
But I will show it off in a battle. Okay. I'll show them both off.
Yes.
And then there's the bunnies, and you feed them the herbs, and then they're all happy. And then you just hit skip. And then they give you herbs.
Herbs are good.
So now, show off the level up mechanic. Hmm. See, I can get myself a new ink pot just by... Bink!
Boom. That's kind of useful. I think you'd want that.
Oh, yes. Yes, you do. Mm. And there are sometimes... Ah, here we go. Little references to Clover. You dig it up.
And now you make it grow. Through the power of the sun.
I'm not going to use that. I'm going to show off something that maybe people didn't know. If you use triangle, you use a heavier ink blot.
Yes. I saw that in the manual.
I don't really remember if it actually does anything.
I don't know. Yeah, it's actually, according to the manual, it becomes pressure sensitive. I know maybe not everybody realizes the PS2 actually has pressure sensitive buttons.
I didn't, actually.
Oh, yes. It's pretty hard to get an exact amount, so. A lot of people don't realize, but yeah. I know, for instance, Metal Gear makes a lot of use of it. Mm. Metal Gear Solid 2. It actually pays attention to how hard you press the button. No time for that now. Here's a cutscene. Bonjour.
Yeah, for some reason this guy's French.
I don't know. I'm guessing you probably use a lot of English or something in the Japanese version.
Maybe. I reckon. So he has a southern accent, maybe?
Well, actually,
maybe he's Cajun.
Yeah, there you go.
Maybe he's from Louisiana.
Nolens?
For Nolens.
That's something actually a lot of characters...
Oh, but here's something. Everybody else just sees Amaterasu as a wolf.
Yes, I remember that.
So, most people actually don't see the mirror and the stripes.
Yeah, There was something actually they did in the localization is, of course, give the characters different accents since they couldn't differentiate their speech patterns the same way they would in Japanese.
I love the way Amateras is like, what? Oh, that's right. I have to fight him in his lightsaber.
Hmm. All right, so I guess,
We. Haha, pun intended.
Super yummy.
Yes, and then the sword gets sort of regenerated after the battle of battle with Orochi.
Yeah, that's actually also another god.
Magnifique.
Oh, c'est magnifique.
Oh my god, I forgot his sword was called Pillow Talk.
Come on, Capcom. This is supposed to be a family-friendly show.
And then he whips out another sword.
Yeah, why not?
And walks on water.
Sure.
Let's rock, baby. Okay, now he's Bruce Campbell.
Yeah.
Give me some sugar, baby.
That was his name right there, but it's too fast for me to read this whole thing. Looks like it's another one they shortened. Could be like Waka or something like that. There you go. Way to beat him. Did he hit? I couldn't tell if he hit you or not.
He did, but I had a bit of a shield thing going on.
Okay. Why are you in the option screen?
I hit the wrong button.
Input error.
Because I'm going to switch. Show off. Because. Oops.
Yeah, I think actually, you won't probably. You're probably meant to beat him with the beads since you just got them.
But also, blast him. I missed my cue.
Yeah, so, I mean, you might be able to... Do you have a parry for the mirror?
Kind of.
You might want to use that, because you're getting in trouble.
Yeah, I'm used to this again. Ha! He lost his color!
Oh, he's too far away. I think you missed your chance. Yeah. Yeah, see, it flashed green there for a second, so.
That's when you perfectly time it.
Yeah, so I think that'll. That might get you an opening if you can time it right.
Yeah.
Right, now we might be hitting some lag since we're using the HD TV today.
Yeah, I think that's what's going on. Aha!
This is for you folks at home. It gets you a better picture. I hope you appreciate it.
Aha!
There you are. Come on. You can do it. So one of the things where you have to dodge his attacks and then wait for your opening. That water is definitely a problem since apparently even though you're a wolf you can't swim. Oh.
That's never happened to me before.
Oh dear.
I honestly do think it's the lag on the TV.
It could be. Yeah, unfortunately we don't have a TV right now that'll support the component cables that we're using for PS2. And of course, at some point, we're gonna play something that supports 480p. There are a handful of games on PS2 that will, though unfortunately, this isn't one of them.
The rosary beads have ridiculous range on
them.
Yeah.
So supposedly he knows you, eh?
Yeah. Amaterasu seems to have some sort of amnesia.
Well, she was sleeping for a long time.
Yeah.
You don't say.
Notice the musical shift when they mention Orochi.
Interesting. It's a fun touch. So we're getting some important story details right now.
Yeah.
Aha.
The beast's evil. Oh, right, there's that bear. I forget what to do with that bear.
I don't know. We're probably not going to find out now.
See that little pod that was floating there? You can use your power to make that a whip.
Nice.
And
she was sleeping through it.
Terasu doesn't care.
So I think we'll finish this cutscene and I know you'd like to keep playing.
Well, no, it'd be nice to get to a constellation.
Yeah, I don't think we're going to be able to. We're already been playing for about a half hour, so.
So I'll get to a save point. I know where that is.
Oh, you don't have to worry about saving.
Yeah, Amaterasu has like a quarter of her powers at this point.
Right. Yeah, so, you know, the normal hero is weakened and you have to rebuild your powers. Like, it's a pretty long cutscene, actually.
Yeah. And there's no way to speed up the text.
Yeah, no, I remember that being a bit of an annoyance.
When you played it three times through. A log and big thrills. That's what she said.
Yeah, Capcom's just making it hard for us to keep the show family-friendly right now.
Au revoir, baby.
There you go. With his wings or his hair, or I don't even know what's going on with that.
What?
So,
yeah.
Results. Yeah, this is actually another thing that's common also on Platinum games is they rank you after every battle. So that's something they brought forward to Platinum, having ranks. And I think that's about as far as we can get right now. So go ahead and pause it and I will. Don't worry about getting to the save point on. Okay, we'll open this and that'll be
just another one of those things you find along the way that you just have to remember which.
Nice, so you got a power up.
Power to use.
Yeah, so. There you go. Yeah, before we quit, walk over to that fish.
Yeah. There. Oh.
Okay, there we go. All right. So.
Just gonna.
Now, if you see, that face is actually made up of basic characters. The eyebrows are a character for Hei. The eyes are No. The mouth is also Hei. I think the nose is Mo. And the little sweat drops are E, if I'm remembering correctly.
So
those are all, you know, little basic characters, little face you can make. I think this is probably also some mnemonic device they use to help kids remember the characters. So that is just, I think, a really beautiful game.
Fantastic. Even more so if you buy it off PSN.
Yeah, I mean, the controls really tight.
Controls are tight, intuitive, just, and the gameplay is just fantastic.
Yeah.
The story is good. Again, not too many horrible plot twists, but it's good. It's fantastic.
I think they definitely took a lot of care in localizing it. They said the reason they didn't want to just wholesale change the names is that they wanted it to be recognizable.
Yeah, and it'd be weird if you were playing in a universe like that and, you know, you ran into John the hero.
Yeah. They wanted it to be, like, if you were curious about the mythological references, that they were close enough that you could look it up and, like, learn more about it.
With the Googs.
Exactly. Yes. They had a Google back then. It was 2006. It's fine.
Yeah. The Googs.
Hold on. Let me Google that for you.
It's just fantastic. It's one of, in my opinion, it's one of the best games to come out on the PS2.
Absolutely. It's such a great game.
That Star Wars Battlefront 2 and one of the Budokai games sucked up so much time for me.
Oh, the design is great. I think, you know, Kamiya is just an excellent designer.
Yeah.
I don't think he's made a bad game, really. Definitely not this one. This was an excellent game. I don't think you can say enough nice things, but at this point we're just repeating ourselves saying how great we think it is.
Yeah.
So, you know, people didn't listen to me before. Listen to me now. Buy Okami. It's available right now on PlayStation 3. It's a digital download. You don't have to worry about it selling out.
Buy the HD edition. Play it. You love it.
Yeah.
If you like RPGs, if you like Legend of Zelda, you'll love it.
Yeah. Hexadrive did a really good job porting it. They also, they're responsible for the current state of the HD version of Zone of the Enders 2. Originally, it was the original developers did a poor job. They actually went in and fixed it. So now the PS3 version of Zone of the Enders 2 is really good, thanks to Hexadrive. So they kind of specialize in porting. They're one of the studios that specialize in porting games.
It just feels like they copied and remastered it. They made it HD. They didn't really change anything.
It's widescreen now.
Well, yeah.
I think they, you know, did things like upgrade the texture quality, and it supports the PlayStation Move. So if you feel like you want to be able to draw with your hand, you can. Though, honestly, I think you're probably better off just playing it with
DualShock. I think you get the best experience just using the DualShock 3.
Yeah.
I mean, really.
Or if you bought your PlayStation 3 a long time ago with 6-axis.
6-axis, DualShock 3, whatever it happens.
Whatever you have, just, you know, just use it.
A regular controller.
Regular controller is where we're going with that.
It's how it works.
And, of course, as I mentioned earlier, all the people who worked on this game are now at Platinum Games, who make best action games in the industry. Yeah. Up at the top, super smooth stuff. Kamiya is very good about always having you be in control of the game.
I mean, really, when I played this on PS2, when I played it on PS3, when I wasn't having that lag problem, eventually you just get so good at it, you hardly ever take damage in a fight.
Yeah.
You know, you get attacked and you're just ready to dodge. You're just ready to use your mirror. You just know what's going on.
Yeah, they've definitely brought forward the parry mechanic. That's something, there's always, in Platinum games, there's generally something you can do if you, like, dodge or block at just the last minute. You get an opportunity to counterattack.
Yeah, I wasn't really able to show it off in that, but if you, you might have to get a power-up. You might have to buy the ability.
Yeah, sometimes you do.
That when you use the mirror and you get it perfectly timed when they melee you, the mirror grabs them, and you jump up in the air and slam them down.
Yes, that's, remember, you actually have the Izuna drop, which is fun. The old ninja standby throw.
Yeah, and it
spinning
works.
Pile driver. That's fun time. Yeah, they have stuff like that. I mean, they brought forward Bayonetta. You have, if you dodge at the last minute, you get Witch Time, where everything slows down. You can attack. They have you know, a mechanic like that in Wonderful 101. Even with the Transformers game that just came out with, you get a last minute dodge, and you know, things will slow down. You can get lots of damage. So they just make some of the best, you know, smoothest action games.
And Okami is just,
yeah,
it's smooth. It's wicked playable, wicked replayable. because the game is so long, you forget what you did at the beginning. And when you beat the game, you can do, like, a new game plus mode.
New game plus.
You don't... there are four mirrors, four beads, and four swords, but you don't keep the last of each one when you go to restart it in New Game Plus. You keep the first three of each, okay, because the other ones are like, I forget if they're story, just they don't want you to be too overpowered at the beginning.
Now, I'm trying to remember, do they replace each other or do they have like different abilities?
Some of them have different abilities. I do remember one of the mirrors having ink bullet ability.
Okay.
When you have it equipped and you lay down when you go to use the celestial brush, and that's where that pressure comes in handy, that bigger ink blot.
Right.
Because you can hurt things by using ink bullets, and you basically, when you stop time with it, you just put a dot on it, and when it comes back, it just hurts them. And if you use a bigger blotch, it hurts them more. It also comes in handy when you get the fireball ability, which again, you have to go through this little side quest to get, where when you draw an infinity symbol, the bigger it is and the more ink you use, the larger the fireball and the more ink bottles get used up. But you use that in the middle of a fight and it can wreck.
Yeah, so, I mean, other than that, they did come up with the DS Okami Den, which I think is supposed to be decent, but I never managed to get a hold of it.
Yeah, I didn't get a hold of it either. I didn't have a DS until late in the game.
I had one. I think I was just kind of broken.
I mostly use it for Pokemon.
Yeah, I wasn't really buying many games at the time.
Gotta catch them all.
I couldn't afford it, so I couldn't get. I missed out on that. Other than that, of course, Amaterasu has reappeared in
Capcom versus Marvel.
Marvel versus Capcom 3.
Yeah, you can play as Amaterasu.
Yeah, it's great because she has all her abilities from the game.
Oh, she does.
You can actually switch between weapons.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, and her super, she'll actually use like all three of the big screen filling things, like when you draw the infinity.
Oh, wow.
So
that's awesome.
And then she's got another one that'll slow down time too. So it's, I think it's a pretty good job bringing her into the game. She's pretty fun to play.
I wish people would play this game more.
Yeah.
And make it known again and demand a sequel, demand another, because I want more.
Yeah. I don't know. It's like all the people who are responsible for it are not at Capcom anymore.
Well, so, who says Capcom has to make it?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if Capcom
again,
and Platinum can make up. And,
well, again, the spiritual successor, like what the people from Rare are doing with Banjo-Kazooie, that works too. Just those same mechanics, that same gameplay style, even if you change the characters, as long as it's done well, no one's going to care.
Yeah. I would say, I mean, you know, you're not probably not never going to get another Okami. But these people are still making games. I would like to see people support Platinum, because I think pretty much all of their games are excellent, to a greater or lesser degree. I mean, maybe some of the licensed ones they've been doing lately aren't up to their high standards. But I think even the mediocre game from Platinum is better than a lot of the other stuff on the market.
Yeah.
And I think they're definitely a developer that's worth supporting that hasn't really seen the commercial success that they deserve for the really polished games they've been making.
Reform Clover.
Well, they did. It's Platinum.
I know.
So that would be my mission, message. Play Okami, support Platinum. If you like good action games.
Play the crap out of Okami.
Yeah.
I know why I did.
Yeah, and past that, I think we'll just be repeating ourselves, so.
Yeah.
I think that's a good place to start. If you like the episode, please give us a like, subscribe to make sure you don't miss future episodes of the show. I've been Dan Mastriani. You can catch me on Twitter at @NewTypeCola.
I'm Ian Butterfield. You can find me on Twitter at @EanGButterfield. We also have a Facebook page, facebook.com/RetroGameConnect. We have the Twitter, which is Retro
Game CNCT.
CNCT. We have a Tumblr, retrogameconnect.tumblr.com.
Yep. Nice and simple.
Watch our other videos if you like. Find us on social media. Talk to us. We don't bite unless you ask.
Depends on what you're into.
We're always happy to talk to people. Yeah. Suggest games. Yeah. If we can get a hold of it for a reasonable price or whatever, yeah, we might play it. Or he might have it in his collection and not even know.
I think I know what all the games I have. If people remind me of them anyway.
Yes. But
I don't think my collection is quite that vast that I am like, did I own that? I guess I do. Though I did manage to once forget that I already owned a version of a Ride and Trad on Genesis, and I bought the Super Nintendo version.
Awkward. But
yeah, it was cheap.
Awkward.
But other than that, we hope you enjoyed the episode. Please join us next time on Retro Game Connect.